Hey, welcome to Sorted. We're a group of mates from London looking for exceptional things in food that'll actually make a difference to your life or just make you laugh. Two of us are chefs, don't worry, the rest of us are normal. And everything we do starts with a suggestion from you. Pancake shape, but I take the cake. I'm gooey in the middle, baby, let me
bake. Hello everyone, I am Barry and this is Mike.
And today we are comparing three bread recipes.
In front of us, we have three different breads. Each one takes a different amount of time to make. Each one takes a different amount of effort to make. And each one has its own special quality.
We are going to eat all three and compare them.
But first, we're going to show you how to make this flatbread.
I know what you're thinking.
What?
Great choice of shirts.
Yeah, thank you very much. Not so bad yourself.
Thank you.
Yes, we are making flatbreads, and they're the easiest breads known to mankind.
We're going to use
self-raising flour,
baking powder,
and natural yogurt.
And to flavour our flatbreads, we're going to use
some blanched almonds,
some pistachios,
some desiccated coconut,
some fancy spices,
and some ghee.
And to bring it all together, we're going to use a mini chopper.
Step one is terribly simple. Take these three ingredients, stick them in a bowl, and bring them together.
Generous pinch.
Generous pinch.
Don't forget a generous pinch of salt.
Because we did. Yeah. Once it starts coming together, you want to flour your surface, get it on there, and bring it together. You don't need to knead it, it's a no-knead dough. Just bring it together so it becomes one.
Oh. And that is your dough done. We're just gonna chuck it into a bowl whilst we make our filling.
I'm just trying to work out how to use this again. There you go, it's on.
It's a hob. So for our spice blend, we decided to fancy it up a little bit. You know, we gave ourselves permission to go fancy. We went for fenugreek, cloves,
look at the shirts,
coriander seeds, mustard seeds, and nigella seeds, otherwise known as black onion seeds.
Did you get them all?
Yeah, I did.
That is impressive.
I know. With our nuts well and truly toasted, it's time to chop them up. Now, obviously, Barry, you could do this by hand if you wanted, but it would take a lot longer, and you probably wouldn't be able to chop it up as small. Oh. It smells so good. Take your big ball of dough, cut it into roughly sixths, then take each sixth, turn it into a disc about the same size as your hand.
Once it's that size, then you want to take a spoonful of your spice mix, put it in the middle, and create a
ball bag.
Money bag. At this point, yeah, they don't look great, but it doesn't matter because we're going to roll them out and this could be merged into the bread.
And as if all of this wasn't easy enough, we don't even need an oven, Barry Taylor.
Oh my goodness, could it get any easier?
Well, we are heating up a griddle pan, which we will throw our flatbreads in for a couple of minutes on each side to char and cook beautifully.
Looks and smells great, but I think you should come over this way, Jay. Together we'll show them how to make gluten-free bread.
To make our gluten-free loaf, we might be taking out the gluten, but we're going to make it rich in lots of other ways.
Yeah, so this is what you're going to need. Plain gluten-free flour.
Sugar.
Salt.
Xanthan gum.
Dried yeast.
And then for the wet stuff, you're going to need milk.
Butter.
Egg white.
And cider vinegar. And to make life easier, we're using a stand mixer with a K-beater attachment.
We're not giving away any prizes for guessing what comes next. We're going to put all of this into there and beat it together.
Yeah, dry stuff first and then the wet stuff. And as always, keep the yeast separate from the salt initially because they don't really like each other. Now, while it's going round, we slop in all the wet stuff.
I know what you're thinking. Butter, milk, cider vinegar in a bread loaf? Are you mad?
It's, well, as we said, it's more of an enriched dough. So it's almost more brioche-y, we're adding stuff in. What you gotta remember is if you are making gluten-free bread, you can't just take a bread recipe and take out the regular flour and put in gluten-free. You need to think about what it's doing. That's why the egg whites are in there as well. So gluten is the protein in flour. If you've taken it out, you need to put something else in. So it's the egg white proteins that are going in. The butter and the milk help to enrich it and give it a kind of an unctuous kind of feeling that you might not get otherwise. But what we're gonna do is kind of scrape it out and kind of plop it into our loaf tin, which is going to be greased with butter. So at this point, we're going to leave our batter to prove again, to make sure it doesn't stick, because although it's not going to quite double in size, it is going to balloon out of this. We want to cover it with cling film, and if you just oil one side of the cling film, then it stops it sticking.
I see what you mean.
I mean, I would have drizzled it a little bit on there and just rubbed it.
But no, Ben, get involved, get your hands involved.
Absolutely perfectly.
Yeah, man, look at that.
And then just loosely drape it over. Leave it in a warm place, so the kitchen is absolutely fine, for about 30 to 40 minutes until it really has ballooned right up. Then bake at 190 degrees for about 50 minutes until golden.
Ah.
Look at that. Results.
That looks very nice, but look at this. I didn't ask you to come over here.
But together we will make.
This is a traditional white loaf.
James and I are going to tackle the classic white loaf. Super simple, but it does need a double prove.
I actually think this is the easiest recipe of the three because it just needs four ingredients. Strong white flour,
yeast,
salt,
and water. And to get real elasticity into it and to save our arms, we're going to use a stand mixer with a dough hook. The yeast is something that doesn't particularly like salt, so we're going to leave them separate in the bowl. And then the yeast is going to react with the natural sugars in the flour, the water, the warmth in the room, and we'll give it some time. And what you end up with is a ballooned, yeasted dough.
I'm so lazy, I always use a stand mixer. It's just super easy. If you're making bread at the weekend, four ingredients, all in, leave it for 10 to 15 minutes. And that's it.
So just a little dusting of flour so you can work with it. And look how soft and pillowy that is. Cover it with a clean tea towel and just leave it in a warm place to double in size.
The next step is our second prove. So this, it's super smooth. You can now touch it without it sticking to your hands. You can scoop that out. You don't need to worry about keeping air in it. That's what the second prove is for. And basically, what I do is just tighten it up into a ball.
And then what we've done is created this nice, smooth, tight top. And that,
I'll just put that on the
goes
inside.
Face down.
And what you see here is that there's no seam at all.
So the second proof, about the same length of time, half an hour, 45 minutes in a warm room. But instead of a tea towel this time, because it is going to balloon up, an oiled piece of cling film so that it doesn't stick.
With bread, when you're proving it, it always depends on the temperature of where you are. So if it's a bit warmer, it'll take a little bit less time. If it's a bit cooler, it might take up to an hour or so or more. It's just when it doubles in size. Yep. And about half an hour before you're ready to bake, preheat your oven, because you don't want to be waiting around.
Yep, nice and high for this one, 220 degrees Celsius.
This is our second prove done. Best bit of making bread. Well, actually, arguably that's eating it, but peeling away.
Which is why you've oiled the cling film. And then we're going to basically dust a baking sheet quite generously with flour. And then go on, James, do your deed. One swift flip and you should get the nice ring marks, and they're moving quickly with a sharp knife, or if you have one, a scalpel. And as soon as you've scored it, get it into your hot oven. And when it's been in there for about 10 or 15 minutes, turn the oven down to 190 to cook all the way through.
Grab a flatbread. Let's get stuck in.
Pa-pow.
I think the ones in the bottom are still warm.
Straight off, it might be quicker, but the char you get from the cast iron griddle rather than the oven of these two gives it a whole nother dimension.
And the flavour that you get from that char is great. It's not burnt, it's charred, and that's a massive difference.
Flatbreads have the perception of being quite bland and boring, but when you pack them through that much spice, they've got a kick.
Now, do you want to try this one? Very different.
Yeah.
Gluten and bread, I think, are synonymous with each other. Take out 50%, what do you get? This.
It looks more like a cake.
It is that kind of density. Mm. So that's really strange. If you didn't tell me that that didn't have gluten in.
It's really buttery.
Yeah, well, we made it buttery.
I know, it's like, it's, I do say gluten-free bread isn't very indulgent, but that is so, it's, coats every part of the mouth.
Yeah.
It's quite cakey in its like texture, but it's brilliant.
It's a little bit sweet, it's a little bit fatty, and it's kind of got that moisture that it really, really needs.
Come on, James, share out your bread.
Oh. I think this probably has the most impressive looking crust.
Oh,
proper bread.
Yeah.
Look at that. Oh.
So of the three, that one to me looks the most inviting.
Yeah.
It looks the most traditional, but sort of rustic, comforting home bake.
It's got that crunchy crust, but it's super soft in the middle. That is everything you want from like a white loaf. So let's try and bring all of these together because they all serve very different purposes. But you know, that one, I'd be happy to eat that just with butter and sit there with the whole loaf and make my way through it.
So bearing in mind, you have to make all of these. Which one is your favorite?
I get what you're doing there, bearing in mind you have to make them.
Mm. I would say, I'm cooking up dinner, I want something to go with it, I'm making that. I've got a Saturday to myself. Never, but I'm making that.
That is the bread, that's the loaf for me. A little bit more time, definitely, but not a huge amount more effort. Ace.
I would go for that.
I'd do that every time, that is by far my favourite bread.
And that's what we've got. We've got no knead, no prove, no oven. This is our gluten-free loaf, if that's what you're looking for. And over here, the classic, the simple, the rustic, the delicious white loaf.
We are full of opinions about these three breads, but I also realise there are probably more than three breads in the world and we might have missed your favourite one. So comment down below, let us know what bread should we be putting on our table.
Don't forget, if you liked that video, then like this video.
Yes, and keep on suggesting what other three things we should make.
Otherwise, make sure you subscribe, make sure you're notified, and we'll see you every Wednesday and Sunday forevermore. Forevermore.
Just to clarify, don't suggest three things, suggest one thing that we can make three times.
Clarity.
Does that make sense?
Clarity.
Good, I like to be clear.
As we mentioned, Sorted is just run by a group of friends, so if you like what we're doing, then there are loads of ways that you can support us and get more involved. Everything you need to know is linked below. Thanks, and see you in a few days.
Fenugreek.
Nigella seeds.
Cloves.
Ah! What's that?
Coriander seeds.
Coriander seeds, I knew that!